प्लीज गेट रेडी फॉर ए डिक्टेशन ऑफ एक्सरसाइज नंबर 18 फ्रॉम अप्रैल 2021 इशू ऑफ प्रोग्रेसिव मैगजीन 5 seconds. Start. Even if all things enumerated above are favorably placed, there still remains the need for enlightened and committed leadership. Your own experience in 1963 amply fortified what I want to say now. At the point of time, India was very fortunate to have been led into experimenting with imported seeds and technology by a very brilliant, adventurous and confidence-inspiring team. Mr. C. Subramaniam was then the Union Minister of Agriculture, but he by himself could have achieved precious little if the bureaucracy led by the Secretary Mr. Sivaraman had not supported him to the hilt with his well-digested briefs. But both of them still would have perhaps been inadequately of India's most far-seeing scientist, Dr. M.S. Swaminathan, were not there to relate the available research and information with the desirability of taking such an initiative. All the three persons from the South stood true and firm in taking the most unwelcome decision of importing 18,000 tons of Mexican seed in 1966, even if each one of them could have lost his head in the bargain. It was a show of administrative drive and political will at their best. There were many more friends who contributed their mite to the success of the wheat revolution in India in no significant a manner. Happily, I can place many of them beaming smiles at me in this august audience. I compliment them on having participated in this high drama at a momentous period in the history of the nation, for it is not so simple to manage to import new technology, particularly in the traditional societies such as India. But it is the illiterate farmer who did the trick with such an ease. Let me here remind my listeners that it is not the scientists but the farmer that finally produces the food. Not that the role of scientists is not important, but the new technologies produced by them have got to be demonstrated to the actual producers, which means the farmers, before they are able to translate dreams into realities. And even demonstration can prove counterproductive if the package does not have the backing of proper economic and political policies. Hence, a good amount of homework has to precede the actual change in agricultural practices. But the results so far have been more than encouraging, and we hope they shall be better. Now I turn to my experience in Africa. Most academicians and intellectuals from the affluent nations were asking, could the Indian or Pakistani or Mexican experience be replicated in the dark continent? Africa is socially and culturally so different, so backward, not yet exposed to modern ideas of mobility and innovation, but it was worth trying. We started with a small transfer of technology in respect of soya and maize 4 years ago. The research in this case had come from two international institutions, namely your own institute at Hyderabad in respect of soya and the Institute of Mexico where I work in respect of maize. We put the information together and demonstrated it to the farmers. There were no credit facilities available. Where from was the small farmer to pay for fertilizers and other inputs? We had to tax our core budget for it. A small cross-section of petty farmers was chosen, and the agreement was that they would pay back in kind at the time of the harvest. Happily, the payback was 100% in the very first year. This was no small miracle. Now, a government bank came forward to arrange finance, of course, cautiously. The second year also had 100% payback. The farmers were very small and cost per head of the experiment not more than $50 per head. The beginning is no doubt small, but the promise is great. Ghana is showing the way. Even if no transport is available, no finance is forthcoming, the food there is abundant. Now, Africa is a great land mass, and even if the growth rate is such that populations can double themselves in 22 years, the present, which means the initial population, is not much, just 650 million. Hence the great potential. But in the pure macro scenario, the population octopus, as I use to call it, though it has many more tentacles than a mere octopus, has assumed far dangerous proportions than we really can imagine. I put it in a simple way. The first time when 1 billion of humans started to live on this planet was 1850 AD. The starting date is the dawn of creation itself, maybe 2 or 3 million years ago. It was truly an achievement of the human being in that he had conquered not only nature, but also death in several ways profound. But the real battle of conquering the communicable diseases was just getting underway in 1850 AD only. Great advances in medical science took place in the later half of the 19th century. Stop.